Can you explain? Because there is this sort of idea that there will be job loss. Now, this is one of those things where I look at it, and even if there is job loss, I'm like, well, that's unfortunate, but they need to find other jobs in a different industry. But I think that that is, like you said, has been so grossly exaggerated as to what would really be the impact on humans. And clearly the advantage outweighs that. I mean, people having healthcare is infinitely more important than some people having to find new jobs. So it clearly weighs it. But what do you tell people that are like in your old position? You know, like if you were explaining to the people that are there, you know, look, they're sitting pretty and making lots and lots of money. So it's like, how do you explain that this is really what's better for our country?
A number of things here. One is that the impact is absolutely exaggerated. If we have a single payer system, if we had Medicare for all, these big companies will not just dry up and go away. They have a lot of divisions that operate outside of health insurance. United, which I mentioned earlier, for example, has a very big and growing and very profitable division called Optum. It doesn't sell health insurance. It does a lot of other things, but not health insurance. Those jobs would not go away necessarily. The other thing is that these companies have been laying people off and offshoring a lot of these jobs over many years. A lot of the claims processing is done overseas. A lot of even the customer service jobs have been offshored and outsourced to companies abroad. So these companies have no allegiance whatsoever to their employees. I've seen, and I had to when I was in the industry myself, have to lay employees off because I had no, you know, it was a directive to do that. It's important to know, Jen, as you said earlier too, that a lot of these jobs are there to deny coverage, to deny care to people. There's actually a job description. You can look it up. It's called denial nurse. And the industry has hired armies of nurses. One of the reasons we have a nurse shortage is because so many of them have been hired by insurance companies. And what they do day in and day out in many cases is say, give people, give doctors and their staffs a hard time becoming a stumbling block for people to get the care that they need. They've hired a lot of doctors as well, too. It may surprise you that United Healthcare is the largest employer of doctors in this country. They now have about 50,000 doctors, and said earlier this year they're going to hire another 10,000. They hire them directly or they buy physician practices. So that's what's been going on. You could have a lot of these people, and I tell folks this, a lot of those employees are clinically trained as caregivers. Let those folks go back into providing care instead of being in positions to deny or delay care. But they, you know, they've got operations spread all over the country. They have operations in Florida. All of them have operations in Florida. Cigna, I know, and United have operations down there. They have facilities, and so they like military contractors. They have employees in congressional districts, and they will tell members of Congress, "Look, if you support this bill, we'll close the operations in Tampa or wherever it might be." So it's that kind of intimidation as well, too. They do have claims processing and customer service operations across the country, but we don't need them. To your point earlier, these companies, you have to question what their value proposition is. And they, shortly before I left the industry, I was in a leadership meeting with our CEO. His name was Ed Hanway at that time. And someone asked him what kept him up at night. And he came out with this big, long word, disintermediation. And then he followed up and said that means that he feared that at some point customers, in particular American businesses, would wake up and begin to question the value proposition. Obviously, that's jargon, but that means that his worry was that corporations would begin to catch on to the fact that they've been sold a bill of goods by insurance companies over many years, and that they don't add value. They just add expenses to employers.
Yeah, there's no added value. They're really just sort of holding an empty bag of nothing. Yeah. They're taking money and skimming money in a process that doesn't need to include them in any way, and yet have convinced all of us that we can't do it without them. I come from a medical family. My husband's a physician. We've been together since I typed his med school applications on a typewriter. So medicine is definitely the hand that feeds us, and most physicians are not generally pro this idea of single payer healthcare because they have been propagandized for so many years that you won't make the same money. It's so bad. Look at them in Canada. So the thing is, we do know a lot of them in Canada, and they have nice lives and they're happy and they have their priorities straight. And the other thing I always point out is, as a doctor, my husband is a small business owner, he can't stand having to deal with paying for his, he'd much rather not have to pay for his employees' insurance and not have to deal with insurance companies and having them tell him what he can and can't do. I mean, there, even if doctors were to, and I've said to him before, even if you were to forego, what if you had to forego some of your income, but we got rid of all of the stress of your life from dealing with managed care? He would do it in a minute.
Yeah.
He would do it in a minute, just dealing with the insurance companies, the staff that they have to deal with these issues. Like, it's so unnecessary.
It is. It's unnecessary. And you go to Canada, and physicians there don't have the same overhead. They don't have the same hassle.
Exactly.
They treat a patient. They submit a claim to the government, and it's paid. And there's no second guessing about what the doctor, how he or she wants to treat the patient. That is not the case here. I often talk about the barriers that insurance companies have erected that make it more and more difficult for people to get the care that they need and the care that their doctors know that they need. They've gotten very aggressive, more aggressive in recent years with what's referred to as prior authorization,
yes.
Which means that doctors have to ask, in many cases beg, for approval before they can treat a patient and expect to get paid for it. It's not just for treatments, but it's for drugs as well too, medications. The other, another major thing, and in fact, I wrote about it today in a Twitter thread, is saddling people with high deductibles, high out-of-pocket costs. People with insurance are not getting the care that they need, not only because of prior authorization restrictions and delays, but because they don't have enough money to pay out of their own pocket what they have to pay before their coverage kicks in. About 40% of Americans, according to the Federal Reserve, don't have $400 to cover an emergency, much
right.
less $8,000 to meet a deductible.
Right.
And that's for a single person.
Yeah.
You can, many families have deductibles of $15,000 or more. So that is a huge barrier, and it causes people to die.
Yeah. I mean, it's the underinsured. It's uninsured and underinsured.
Yeah.
And, you know, what I've been saying for a really long time is, you know, we know that medical costs is like the number one cause of bankruptcies in our country. And the amount of stress and grief and pressure and just general misery yeah. as a result of people not having healthcare, both preventatively and then what happens to them in debt, going into debt afterwards, this chain of events, there's really nothing else like it. It's really something that is extraordinary in that it doesn't have to be that way. And yet we just go through this and we've sold ourselves that we need to have it this way. Like we don't deserve nice things.
We have. We've been sold this line, this thinking for a long, long time. And people we grew up with this system, and we've been told that nobody can do it better than we can. And so we've been told lies that we've believed. Earlier today, I moderated a panel that included a woman in Sacramento, California. The reason she was on this panel was because she had sought treatment at a free medical clinic operated by Remote Area Medical a few years ago. She had been insured by Cigna. She was in a Cigna PPO. But she had to pay so much money out of her own pocket for the care that she needed. Her family went bankrupt. It's just unconscionable that people with insurance are having to file for bankruptcy. And you're exactly right. If you're sick, that's enough to worry about, enough to have to tend to, and to saddle you with the additional worry of how you're going to pay for the care that you need, even with insurance, is absurd. It's insane that we keep putting up with this. Physicians too. I've talked to a lot of physicians, physician groups, and I know that a lot of this is the term moral injury came to be used, during war, that soldiers suffer from moral injury. It's now being applied in the medical profession. Doctors talk about that. They know that they are not able to provide the care that they know their patients need because of the intrusion of insurance companies. And so there's moral injury there. It is a big reason for physician burnout and why a lot of doctors are retiring early and even discouraging their children from going into the practice of medicine.
Thanks for watching. If you want to support our mission to transform politics into service, please like this video, subscribe, follow us on social media, and consider joining our Patreon, where you'll get early access to our interviews as well as other exclusive content. Links are in the description. Peace out.